This is not paradise.
It's that new and it's that explosive.
Police! Police!
Tonight on 48 Hours.
Charges conspiracy to import heroin.
The new Heroin Connection.
Nigeria.
We're going to continue to see a tremendous influx of heroin into the United States.
Oh! They love money and they love guns.
From an accused Asian drug lord's mountain hideaway.
In the long run, drugs are more powerful than your nuclear weapons.
Along the smuggler's trail.
Burma straight ahead.
To America's streets.
How much?
Heroin is marketed so aggressively.
10-4 may be happening now.
You'll meet the cops.
D.E.A.
The unlikely Americans they say are caught up in the drug trade.
I don't even do drugs.
And the kids at the end of the line.
As soon as I used heroin, I knew that it was my drug.
It's coming in. It's coming in all the time in very large amounts.
A new threat from an old enemy, heroin. There is a flood of heroin now entering the United States. Most of it from the Golden Triangle of Southeast Asia, where opium production has tripled in the last 5 years. One reason for the rising tide, competing gangs of smugglers, including the Chinese, Russians, and even Colombians switching away from cocaine. But the most prominent newcomers are drug traffickers from West Africa. Is America on the verge of another heroin epidemic? Our investigation begins at the source.
In Bangkok, ancient customs are crowded by modern problems. There has always been a strong tradition of trading in Thailand. One of its oldest exports, textiles. One of its newest exports, trouble. Heroin.
Well, you've got to remember, this is a source country.
What did you buy here?
It does pretty much originate here.
Been to Bangkok several times, and you always stay at the Del Arca Park?
Bruce Barnes is a DEA agent from America who spends most of his time at the airport in Bangkok.
Why would you buy hangers in Thailand?
I have my boutique in Nigeria, all right?
Bangkok's international airport is one of those crossroads of the world that drives drug enforcement agents crazy. It is one of the most modern airports in Southeast Asia, convenient not just for tourists and businessmen, but also for heroin traffickers.
The technique is unlimited.
I don't know if there's a seam in it, it's pretty good.
Many of them are working for some West African organization, probably the vast majority of them that we come across here.
So many Africans have gone into the business that they're starting to rival the Chinese, who have been the traditional leaders of the heroin trade.
The Nigerians are a phenomenon. They are a problem. They're a problem for the Thais. They're a problem for us in the United States.
Glenn Cooper is the DEA agent in charge of the Bangkok office.
Sometime around 1988 or 89, it became clear to us in DEA that the Nigerians were beginning to come to Thailand to purchase their heroin.
So American and Thai drug agents keep a close eye on the airport.
Where is Italia going?
Looking for people traveling to Europe or Africa with heroin that will be shipped on to the United States.
He'll wait until the individual checks in, until he receives his ticket and his bags are checked. Then they now have a smuggling offense.
Where you stay?
This woman was carrying 8 pounds of heroin.
Nigeria.
Nigerians will come to Bangkok. They'll purchase heroin from established dealers. It'll be distributed to individuals who are acting as couriers, for the most part.
This is the Bangkok neighborhood where most of the connections are made. The drug couriers usually follow a set pattern. They check into a flophouse motel and sit by the phone, waiting for someone to call, telling them when and where to pick up the heroin. More than 200 West African couriers are now doing time in Thai prisons for heroin smuggling. And the DEA believes that is a small percentage of the total number of smugglers.
What we want to check for, too, is the last minute arrivals on both.
At the airport, the authorities look for people who fit a profile.
A number of things lead up to a profile.
Just one bag you have?
Hand luggage.
Only one?
Yes.
A number of pieces of luggage.
Is your passport?
Yeah.
An overall view of the individual and himself.
You have been to America?
Yeah. Huh? One time.
Any nervous tendencies?
Okay, you can go.
This man was not carrying heroin. Smugglers carry heroin in anything they can.
Televisions, refrigerators, electrical extension cords.
Even their own bodies. This is an X-ray of one man who was arrested recently.
You'll have some couriers who are what we call swallowers. They will swallow 50 or 60 small, they're not balloons, but they're the fingers of surgical rubber gloves. They're filled with heroin.
Very hot, very strong.
Authorities have been waiting 10 hours for nature to take its course. The count so far, 65 pellets of heroin. Tonight, the authorities are suspicious of this man.
This particular individual had a Sierra Leone passport, which we traditionally have found many of them to be false or fictitious.
The agent's score, about 6.5 pounds of heroin, 99% pure. Street value in the United States, over $2.5 million.
What do you use these for? What are the gloves for?
Hairdresser.
Hairdresser?
Yes.
He is in deep trouble.
Don't kill me. I beg. My teeth killed me.
Getting caught smuggling drugs out of Thailand can mean the death penalty. Using couriers from West Africa has become too obvious, too risky. So the leaders of the Nigerian connection have begun recruiting mules from other areas.
We went for it. We were the bait.
Including the U.S.
We never thought we were going to make it here. We thought we were going to make it home.
Later in our 48 hours, we'll meet some of the unlucky ones.
I can't go back.
When you think of Dallas, you think of the TV show. You think of oil. You think of cattle. And everybody knows about the Dallas Cowboys.
Touchdown, Dallas!
But when you think of Dallas, there's one thing you probably never knew, that this city is home for an army of American foot soldiers who smuggle drugs from Asia to the United States for their Nigerian bosses. In fact, the Nigerian heroin traffickers now find more drug couriers right here in Dallas, Texas, than just about anywhere in the entire United States.
This is it.
What this is the Dallas connection, so new that it's just now coming to light. You're looking at a raid by DEA agents, of all places, in a quiet suburban Dallas neighborhood. They're looking for someone they say is a heroin courier.
Hi, Tony Rust, federal agent.
Yes.
Step back inside, please.
I have a federal warrant for your arrest. Yes, ma'am. Charges conspiracy to import heroin.
No, sir, I've never done anything like that.
Well,
I don't even do drugs.
Before I ask you any questions, you have the right to remain silent.
She was part of a team that left the United States, was recruited by Nigerians to go to Bangkok, Thailand, and pick up a suitcase containing 7 pounds of heroin.
Marty Prock is the DEA agent in charge.
She took it from Bangkok to Vienna.
That's correct.
That's the allegation.
That's correct.
The DEA says in Vienna, she gave the heroin to these two men, who are also from Dallas. They allegedly were going to smuggle the drugs into the United States, but were arrested over there.
My interest lies in the Nigerians that are behind this. And we'll take you down to our office and we'll talk to you more about this thing.
How many people are out there from Dallas, Texas, who are running drugs?
We have identified over 100 people that are involved in this.
This man works undercover for the DEA.
If I had asked you that same question a year ago, what would you say?
I would have said that I didn't think it was going on here. It's that new and it's that explosive.
Why? What is it about Dallas?
There's a considerable number of Nigerians that are actually located here. It could be a number of factors. The large number of Nigerians that are engaged in this activity, Dallas being a hub into Europe and into Asia.
Just relax and let me do all this.
And like a lot of the people the Nigerians recruit, this woman was in debt. She's an unemployed sales clerk.
Right now, she's been away from work for a couple of months. She needs money.
If she's guilty, she doesn't look like a typical drug smuggler, does she?
I would say that that's exactly what the Nigerians are looking for in their recruitment. The trend in the past has been using young males and females between the ages of 19 and 24.
Right.
And they're just recently starting to go to older women.
So if the DEA has been looking for younger couriers, the Nigerians are determined to hire older ones.
And they're looking for females between the ages of 35 and 50.
How does a Nigerian find somebody like this?
Well, that's some of the people have been found by the Nigerians coming around driving cabs, picking people up at various locations and talking to them.
You serious?
Seriously.
You understand you're in quite a bit of trouble right now.
Yes.
What are you thinking?
I'm scared. I'm a single parent. I'm worried about my kids. I know I did wrong. I was taken advantage of. I should have known better.
How did you get involved in this in the first place?
Some people that I knew briefly told me about it. The man contacted me by phone. We were told that there were diamonds hidden in the bag.
What was in it for you?
We were supposed to be paid $10,000. I knew it was wrong, but I was desperate. I thought it would be a way to get out of the situation that I was in. But I still wouldn't have done it if I'd have known it was heroin. I never would have done it.
Is that a ridiculous story?
Yes. I think it's an unbelievable story.
You don't believe her?
No, I don't believe her.
Without the mask, some Nigerian recruiters would recognize him because they think he's one of their couriers. In fact, they even sent this DEA agent all the way from Dallas to Africa once to pick up some heroin. He showed us the suitcase they gave her.
What's the story here?
Appears to be empty. On this side, after we removed the inner lining, fiberglass shell that duplicates the external part of the suitcase.
And underneath this?
Underneath this was concealed a plastic bag that had about 3 pounds of heroin in it.
This is the tape the DEA shot as they actually tore open the suitcase.
3 pounds of heroin.
Mm-hmm.
Street value?
Roughly $240,000.
Okay.
Just a few minutes after he said that, news reaches Dallas about a big heroin bust overseas.
Vienna police say that 27 pounds of pure heroin originating from Thailand have been confiscated.
Six Americans have been arrested in Vienna on charges of smuggling heroin for Nigerian traffickers. Five of the six are from Dallas.
Austrian police say the arrests crack a major European drug smuggling operation.
But this is one of those good news, bad news stories.
It don't look like there's anybody home to me.
The DEA is worried that the people they're looking for in Dallas may now go underground.
The efforts here of trying to locate them might be futile now.
They're looking for a man who they say was working with the woman they arrested earlier.
Tim Stover with the D.E.A.
They find him just after he gets home from his job. He's a construction worker.
The two bags that you delivered over there from Bangkok to Vienna?
Yes.
Contain 7 pounds of heroin in them. Right back with me, sir.
And they also arrested this man, a Nigerian alleged to be a major recruiter. He drives a taxi in Dallas.
It's like an anthill. We're getting, as we go deeper and deeper, we're finding out spreading further and further.
And the DEA says one of the reasons they're arresting more and more people is because of this woman, who says she was a secretary and a waitress in Dallas when a friend introduced her to a Nigerian who made her an offer she wouldn't refuse.
I traveled to Bangkok, Thailand to pick up a suitcase with heroin built into it to bring to Switzerland.
You were a courier?
Yes.
How many trips did you make for the Nigerians?
Just one.
One?
Yes.
When her contact asked her to make another drug run, she said no and went to the DEA in exchange for immunity from prosecution. Now she says she fears for her life.
I'm scared to death. I have 2 children. I'm afraid for their lives as well as mine.
The DEA thinks she has reason to worry, so the federal government has moved her and her children. As for this woman, if she's convicted, she could get 10 years to life in prison.
The message that I would like to send out, you know, to everyone is if you're approached with a get-rich-quick scheme and includes a trip overseas, all expense paid, think twice about it because chances are good you're going to go to jail. And it might not be an American jail, it might be a foreign jail.
City, when you talk about heroin, you're saying it's dope.
Yeah, you might be copping right now.
It's so simple, it's scary that you can get it in so many places.
Heroin may have disappeared from the public consciousness, but it has never left the streets of New York. What's new is that there's a lot more of it. It's cheaper, and it's of higher quality.
It's just that there's so many new places to buy heroin and so many new brand names out there that it's hard for the unit ourselves to keep up with everything.
This man works undercover, but he's not a cop.
Let's walk over here and see if we can get some more.
He's a former drug addict working for a state agency that monitors the drug scene.
People come out here because we want to know what these people out in the street are using.
So why are they all running, John?
They're all dirty.
John Gallia, a former police detective, runs the street surveillance unit.
My people fit right into the drug culture itself. They're able to go in, speak to the people, watch and see what's going on, and then report back to me.
What do you call those people who go out there?
Brave.
Where's my girl?
Not here.
We went along with one of Gallia's street people. We'll call him Jake.
Are they armed when they're out there?
They're only armed with their experience.
What did he just say?
Hot party, man. That's the one I'm gonna buy for it.
Hot party, is that like the
brand name?
What we found in New York's East Harlem was a virtual outdoor shopping mall of heroin.
That's bad.
How much?
She ain't gonna buy it. She likes to talk. Cool out. People are constantly hawking what drugs they have. It's all heroin, but it's all under different brand names.
Listen carefully and you'll hear the brand names.
Tombstone.
Poison. Jake says the heroin is so good that for the first time, some junkies are abandoning their needles. It's pure enough to snort or smoke.
Back in the mid-70s to 80, early 80s, you know, sniffing coke was like the thing. Now it seems like sniffing dope is the thing.
I mean, how big are we talking about? Are we talking about something that could replace cocaine?
Yes. As we stand here in East Harlem, people that usually sold crack are now selling heroin. We have observed data that heroin is being marketed very aggressively.
We have just paid the cooperating individual, and we're getting ready to go over to the first purchase location.
The DEA is also on the street. and worried about the high purity of heroin.
Is there a reason why you picked that place?
Yeah, there's dope there.
Every month, the DEA sends out informants to buy heroin.
Might be copying right now.
Right here, we have five exhibits. This is the first one in the Bronx, and the first one of the day was checkmate.
What's the purpose of this? What will you do with this?
This information gets sent to a laboratory, a special testing laboratory, and it determines the location of the origin of the heroin, the purity, diluents, and adulterants that are used in the mixtures of heroin.
With the DEA's okay, we followed the drug sample from the South Bronx to a secret lab outside Washington.
That's heroin.
After a week of tests at the Space Age facility, the heroin bought in the Bronx was determined to be from Southeast Asia and 43% pure.
10 years ago when I was making buys in Harlem, it was 3, 4, 6% heroin. So, I mean, it's been a dramatic increase.
Jerry Winthrop is an undercover agent for the DEA.
Plain capitalism, supply and demand. Go for the best product, for the price.
When you're marketing it to the level where it's going out on the street at a high purity, there has to be a reason to do that.
John Dowd, also with the DEA.
You're talking economics and you're talking building up a clientele, that's what I would say.
So what appears to be happening is a major shift in market strategy. Classic Coke being replaced by a new and improved product line aimed at a new consumer.
You get your white middle class user and they go into the discos and sniff. And they think that's not as bad as using a needle.
But with brand names like Suicide and Body Bag, this is one case where you truly get what you pay for.
As soon as I used heroin, I knew that it was my drug.
I never really had any supervision when I was young.
I could do it in school. I used to do it in classes.
I developed a habit when I was about 12 and a half.
And I was using heroin every day.
These young addicts were all treated at New York City's Regent Hospital, where there is concern about a growing trend toward heroin use.
I'm frightened about it because I am seeing 14-year-old kids who are already addicted to heroin.
Thanks, Esther.
Dr. Lorraine Hendricks runs the hospital's adolescent drug treatment program.
They're 12 to 21 years of age.
How do young people get involved with heroin?
Most people who abuse heroin, I would say most, have also abused cocaine. It's almost like there are two white substances. One is cocaine and one is heroin, and you use one and then you use the other one.
Was it a big step for you to move from cocaine to heroin?
Not to me.
Jason, age 22, went from sniffing heroin to shooting it into his arm.
I was actually proud of it at that time. In my own sick way, I was, I believed that I was graduating. I was becoming a real drug addict, real tough guy.
It's not hard at all to get it. I mean, you can get it anywhere, seriously.
18-year-old Chris discovered heroin on the New York nightclub scene.
No one was in the bathroom to go to the bathroom. People used to smoke pot, do cocaine, you know, snort heroin.
And at one point, I was sniffing $100 a day, $150 a day. Then
19-year-old Sandra sold heroin and paid a very high price. She ended up in jail.
Then the second time I was arrested, I spent 4 days in the bullpens, sick as a dog. I was pregnant, 4 months pregnant, I had a miscarriage.
People are looking for something different.
In spite of the risks, Jason thinks that more kids will try heroin as they search for a new kind of high.
It's the hot drug now?
I don't know if it's exactly hot yet, but it's definitely on the rise.
Now I see little kids, I'm talking about, like, I call them little, but I was the same age, but 14, 15-year-old kids selling heroin and crack, it's just like, oh, well, now you can walk and talk. Well, here's a bag of dope. Go sell it, you know? I mean, it's just like the norm.
If you walked out the front door today, if you had the money and if you were determined to buy heroin, how long would it take you to find it?
15 minutes.
Still ahead on 48 Hours. Freedom fighter,
ching, boom,
or drug lord? The U.S. indicted him. Phil Jones found him. And it wasn't easy.
This is devastating.
Also an innocent victim of the drug war. This used to be her house.
This is opium?
Yes.
48 Hours will continue.
A new day is just beginning, and we're headed off on what will be a long journey into the heart of the Golden Triangle. Yes. We're in northern Thailand right now. Laos is over in that direction, and Burma's straight ahead.
Burma, with its rich hillsides of poppies, the source of the world's biggest crop of opium. Opium that's processed into heroin, and heroin that's now flooding into the United States. It's produced by clandestine labs in Burma and protected by rebel armies.
We're coming up to the Thai border with Burma. On the other side, over there, a rebel zone known as the Shan State.
It's controlled by a warlord known as Khun Sa, the king of opium.
Some people say I am the devil. They think I have fangs and horns. But I'm human. The real vampires are the ones that take all your taxpayers' money. Your drug policy will never work. The drug flow will get bigger and bigger.
He's the top. I mean, there's no one bigger than Khun Sa in the heroin trade.
Kathy Palmer is on his trail.
We'll get him one of these days.
She's a U.S. prosecutor in Brooklyn, armed with an indictment against Khun Sa for drug trafficking.
We in America are very familiar now with all the cocaine kings. They pale in comparison to Khun Sa. 50% of heroin that comes into the United States comes from Khun Sa's fields.
Our problem is to get the Shan Nation its independence. Your problem is the drug problem. It's not my problem.
Khun Sa prefers to be seen as a freedom fighter. Defender of 8 million people called the Shans. A rebel general leading the charge against Burma's military dictatorship.
I've heard about how large your army is. Would you tell me, how large is it?
Nearly 40,000 men in arms, both active and reserves.
It obviously costs a lot of money to keep this army going.
We love money and we love guns.
Sang Joy is a foreign affairs official in the Muang Thai Army.
Where do you get the money to keep this army?
We have 60% coming from the tax from opium, because opium have done a good thing, a good turn for the Shan Revolution.
It's a revolution that is already sowing its own future.
This is an incredible scene. These little kids with wooden rifles. How old are they?
They are 10 years to 15 years old. We train them into handle guns and artillery. We have to defend ourselves from the tyrants that is oppressing the Shan people.
The army.
It's a drug army.
It's not about independence for the Shan state?
No, it's not about human rights in Burma. It's about control of the opium.
Realistically, looking at these 10-year-old kids and up, what's ahead for them?
For the moment, it's blood and guts.
Blood and guts.
16 is the age where they join the front lines.
This is the front line, the battle for Doi Lang, a killing field in a fight for the opium field. Khun Sa's enemy, another tribal army called the Wa.
Why all these battles? What do they Wa want?
They want to control opium trafficking across the borders. This is one of the casualties from the front line. He stepped on a booby trap.
Boom!
The soldier was also hit. All casualties from fighting the war. I love the soldiers and they love me also.
In the last 3 years, you've had 600 of your men killed, 1,500 wounded in war. Is that love?
It's worth it.
It's worth it.
The enemy is suffering even more casualties.
There is one casualty the Shan share with the American drug war.
I have suffered much because of this one.
Drug addicts. 68 are now in treatment in this rehabilitation center.
What is this?
This is a pit. This is the first stage that the dope addict is treated.
A pit?
You just confine him in this pit for 3 days.
They do not share our treatment methods.
They simply put me in a hole, you know,
and locked the door.
I didn't even know I'm asleep or awake sometimes.
Screaming, yelling.
I didn't even know I was yelling. I would dream about the opium, come near me. I put my hand on it and it disappeared like that.
But if everybody understands the suffering that occurs, why not just stop growing the poppy and the opium?
I think they can stop growing if they have something to eat. They are very poor.
We rely on opium to buy clothes, to buy rice. Opium is the most important thing in our life.
He's a village chief of a hill tribe that harvests opium.
The whole village plants poppies, and they all pay the tax.
Is this General Khun Sa?
Oh, that's right.
Have you ever heard of heroin?
It's beyond my wisdom.
Have you ever heard of America?
I have never known what America means.
This is opium?
Oh. Yes.
It's good, huh?
The best.
Do you make a lot of money?
I made $160 from my harvest. Not even enough to feed my family. I am very poor.
I raise chickens. I raise mushrooms. The D.E.A. only know me for opium. I am not trafficking. I just tax drugs. If you want me to stop, just send me some money.
Any idea what this man is worth?
Easily hundreds of millions. Easily. He controls the heroin refineries in the Golden Triangle.
In the long run, drugs are more powerful than your nuclear weapons. They don't blast off if you don't press the trigger. But as for drugs, if you try to put a brake on heroin, it won't stop. It just goes on and on.
Lieutenant John Gallo, I'm a...
Big needles here.
Lieutenant in the Narcotics Field Unit of the Philadelphia Police Department. White cops, he just said. In this area, right in this area, yes, it's all heroin.
North Philadelphia is just one destination for the heroin connection.
They deal out of this little passageway here, alleyway.
It's home to the heaviest concentrations of drug abuse and murder in the city.
Now you got kids coming back from school and you got these nitwits out here selling dope on the street.
It's a shame. It's a shame, because there's so many people out here wasting their lives and they ain't got nothing better to do.
Are you seeing more heroin now than, say, 4 years ago, 2 years ago? Are we seeing more now? Mm-hmm. Yeah.
it's not overwhelming at this point yet, but there's a lot of it out there.
This is where they live. They just take over these houses.
This abandoned building is a shooting gallery.
This is a place of heroin-y people here.
Complete with house rules and a cover charge.
And please pay rich or $3 or more and as you take off. As soon as you take off, that don't mean going down to the international airport to fly to New York, you know? The house is in violation of every law known to man.
Oh, man, this cost me $20,
man. I know, baby, but...
I don't like being like this. I don't like, you know, having to use heroin every day, waking up every morning, feeling like sh- until you get this sh- inside of you. I don't like it at all.
And how often do you do it?
I can't understand why you would have an abscess.
8-9 times, maybe more.
A day?
And you do not want us to pay a return visit, okay?
You got any needles on you?
No.
Any needles on it?
Knives, guns, hand grenades, explosives.
Four layers of clothes? Cold out here, standing out here on the street selling heroin? You think this is very humorous, don't you? This is funny, ain't it? This is real funny. You killing all these people and stuff, it's hilarious. No job, all this money. You rank right up there with one of the all-time scourges of mankind, you know that?
The street fight against drugs in Philadelphia is now taking a new turn.
This is a major heroin operation we're going to.
They're still going after the drug suppliers.
There's two shotguns to protect them, and that's altogether 14 bundles of heroin. That's a lot of dope.
A man's selling, we can nail him.
They're still going after the street dealers.
Were you selling?
Me? No, I was buying.
You were buying?
I only got one bag on me. What am I going to buy?
Be careful back here. This is not a happy place.
Did you find anyone here?
No, no one in here.
Find any drugs?
No. Shooting gallery, 90 mil. I'm sure there's enough drugs here if you squeeze all these needles out.
I mean,
just heroin needles.
But now they're going after the buildings.
Okay, tell me what structurally is wrong with these properties.
Front and rear walls are totally in a state of collapse.
Okay.
Buildings where the drugs are stashed, sold, and used.
All three of these houses will be demolished. And then the drug dealers have nothing to go back to. Suddenly they don't have a home to sell their drugs from.
Assistant District Attorney Pam Dunleavy spearheads the effort called
Operation Genesis.
Once a city building inspector says,
it's definitely an imminently dangerous condition.
The building is ready for wrecking.
But aren't you just pushing the problem to another block or to another community?
The drug situation is moving on its own from block to block to block. Everyone's family is being touched by it in one way or another.
Is this one of our knockdown?
Yes, ma'am.
Good, oh, isn't that wonderful?
Upstairs is clear.
Good. How is this going to improve it? How is this operation going to make it better?
Well, if I were to tell you that by taking these buildings down, by demolishing them, that this is going to be the end of the drug problem, I'd be a liar.
Lynn Abraham is Philadelphia's district attorney.
It's a, what I would call it is a small skirmish in a very big war.
This war, like all wars, has innocent victims.
And I walked out of that house every morning, and returned every evening around 4:35. And I know they know I live there.
Helen Anthony was at work when Operation Genesis came calling.
I want the place searched thoroughly.
Everything that I owned for 40 years was in that house. Everything that I owned.
Days later, she and her family are still picking belongings from the rubble.
These would be my dad's pants.
All my kids' wedding pictures, grandchildren pictures. It's a devastating.
Finding some things.
There's my sixth grade picture.
Your sixth grade picture?
Yes.
Still looking for others.
That's one of the better pictures we have of my father. We don't have, right now, we don't have any damn pictures of my father. We don't have nothing else.
They should have notified me. And even as of now, not one person have came to me and said, Miss Anthony, we are sorry for what happened.
The war against drugs cost Helen Anthony her home.
Brand new dishes.
Brand new dishes.
And while she negotiates with the city for compensation, she still believes the battle must be fought.
I agree that they need to do something with the whole neighborhood. And I will 100% behind them with that.
I think when you start in on any war, you never know for sure if you're going to win it. You just have to do it a battle at a time.
Is this a needle in here? Man, if I find a needle in here, that is a needle.
They call Bangkok the City of Angels. If you're a tourist, it is one of the most exotic places in Southeast Asia. If you're a heroin smuggler, it is one of the most dangerous. Punishment is sure and swift and severe. They are almost always convicted, and foreigners usually get 25 years in prison. No deals, no plea bargaining, no parole.
I was ready to board the plane. I thought I was home free.
These are two of a growing number of Americans, 29, currently held in Thailand for heroin smuggling.
This here is where you sleep.
They are held in prisons so tough, the average life expectancy is 11 years.
Now, this is your food?
That's lunch? That's lunch.
And you're facing what kind of time?
Either death penalty or 25 years.
One week earlier, they were caught trying to smuggle heroin strapped to their thighs aboard a flight to New York.
We never thought we were going to make it here. We thought we were going to make it home.
They told us their names are Rachel and Velma. Rachel is 24, Velma is 22.
Do you think about what your life, day to day, month by month, will be like for 25 years?
Oh, God forgive me, because I have a child, and he needs his mother. But I'll commit suicide. I can't be here for 25 years. That's killing me. I mean, I can understand if you were to murder somebody, then give me life.
You were smuggling heroin. Heroin. And a lot of people might say, and pardon me, this is tough to ask you, because I know what you're facing. But a lot of people would say, the heck with them. They took the chance, they did the crime, let them do the time.
How many people wouldn't do this if they were in the situation that we weren't at home needing the money? How many people wouldn't do this?
They'll be speaking fluent Thai when they leave here, I assure you.
Bruce Barnes of the DEA.
Do you have any sympathy for Rachel and Velma?
3 kilos of heroin, typically 90% when it leaves here, would make you and I a millionaire many times over on the streets of Paterson, New Jersey, or New York City, or anywhere else in the United States for that matter. So it's hard to have sympathy for them, no.
Their trouble began on a street corner in New York.
As far as they put it to us, it was gonna be an easy job, you know? It's like a job.
Where they met a man who said they could make a lot of money smuggling heroin.
And how much were you going to get paid?
From $2,000 to $5,000. And naively, as I can say, because it was very naive about ourselves, we went for it.
Rachel and Velma had never been very far from home, so an offer for an all-expense-paid trip to Bangkok seemed pretty exciting. Their contact in New York even gave them some spending money. They were supposed to travel around and see the sights, at least for a while.
We took trips all over Thailand. We went to the beach, we went shopping. We were tourists. We really enjoyed being tourists until the day somebody contacted us in the hotel and told us to meet him at the mall.
So you went and you met him?
We didn't meet him. He just gave us the bag.
They were given a shopping bag filled with about 7 pounds of heroin.
Is this the stuff that they're bringing in now?
Mm-hmm.
This is what you had?
Mm-hmm. In our legs.
What did he tell you about the risk? What did he tell you about the risk of being caught, of ending up in jail?
They did not say. They did not say.
Did you ask?
Mm-hmm. They would have us out of here in no time.
It's 8:30 a.m. Today, Rachel and Velma see the judge. After that, they go to prison.
Do you have any plan for what you're gonna say?
No.
Tell the judge?
It's scary.
Yeah.
25 years or death penalty. It's not a joke.
Today's court appearance will be the first of many before their actual trial.
Rachel has no excuses for the judge and no excuses for her family, particularly her father.
When he sees this, I'm going to be a dead child to him.
A dead child?
Yes, I would no longer exist to him. He would not forgive me. But all I can say is I'm sorry, because I can't go back. I can't go back.
How serious a threat is the new heroin connection? Everyone agrees that supplies are up dramatically, as is the purity of the drug on the street. But that's where the consensus ends. There's simply not enough conclusive evidence in emergency rooms, in treatment programs, in schools, in prisons, to say flatly that a new epidemic is underway. But a new study says by the time government statistics confirm the danger, it will be too late to stop it. I'm Dan Rather. That's 48 Hours for this week.
They're the most beautiful ex-cops you've ever seen, but they're also the most dangerous. An all-new Dangerous Curves tonight on Crime Time After Prime Time. It's too hot to sleep. Thanks for making CBS America's most watched network. Now get ready for your local news.